In the 1980s and 90s, Serie A was widely viewed as the best league in the world. Virtually every team had a star, some had practically 11, and packed out arenas greeted some of the world's best talent with passion, bright colours, and a wave of noise on a weekly basis. From 1983 to 1998, Italian teams were also the most successful in European competitions, making up 12 out of the 32 European Cup or Champions League finalists during that time, with AC Milan winning 3 European crowns and Juventus winning 2. To contrast that with the last 10 years, Serie A has struggled to attract world football's genuine superstars prior to the arrival of Cristiano Ronaldo, and often quite mediocre players walk out into often quite damp, depressing, and half-empty stadiums most weeks. Over the last 10 seasons, Serie A has had just 2 of a possible 20 Champions League finalists, namely Juventus in 2015 and 2017, who lost on both occasions, meaning Italian football hasn't had a champion of Europe since Inter Milan's unlikely treble win under Jose Mourinho in 2010. If you go back even as recently as the 1998-99 Serie A season, a team like Parma had a starting 11 which boasted the likes of Gianluigi Buffon, Lilian Thuram, Fabio Cannavaro, Dino Baggio, Juan Sebastian Baron, and Hernan Crespo. I could reel off equally impressive names at several Serie A clubs at that time, and others, but it's probably easier to just tell you that Parma only finished 4th that season, a whopping 15 points, behind the ultimate title winners AC Milan. For more than a decade, Serie A had the highest average attendance of any league in Europe, as the brightest and best the world football had to offer flocked to Italy's footballing Mecca. When Diego Maradona lit up the 1986 World Cup, it was in Italy that he played his club football with Napoli. When Michel Platini put any debate as to who was the best footballer in Europe to bed at Euro 84, it was Italy that he called home, starring for Juventus. When the Netherlands were crowned champions of Europe in 1988, their two best players played their club football in Italy, and within a matter of months, Frank Rijkaard had joined them. This was just the way it was. From 1982 to 1998, of the 17 Ballon d'Or winners, a remarkable 13 played their club football in Italy. And from 1988 to 1990, for 3 consecutive seasons, all 9 positions on the Ballon d'Or podium were occupied by stars of Italy's Serie A. In many respects, Italian 90 seemed to be a crescendo of Italian footballing greatness. Whilst the Italian national team didn't win the tournament, half of the West German starting 11 that did played their club football in Italy, as did 7 members of the team of the tournament. Meanwhile, 2 that didn't, Dragan Stojkovic and Paul Gascoigne, would be recruited by Serie A sides over the next couple of years. As the whole world watched packed-out Italian football stadia host arguably the most impressive World Cup to date, lit up primarily by players who played their club football in Serie A, it seemed as though there was nothing that could stop Italian football from steamrolling on into the 21st century. So what on earth happened, you might ask, to Italian football, and particularly to Serie A? As is so often the case, it is more than a sole issue or problem which transpires to take down a great institution like Serie A in the 1980s and 90s, and there are a myriad of problems which have plagued Serie A over the last 20 years, both internal and external. Follow the money is a time-old investigative adage though, and so many of Serie A's problems can be related to financial issues. For almost the entire 20th century, Serie A was the most lucrative football league in Europe. Even as far back as the 1930s, you can read of England internationals who were aghast to hear at how much their Italian counterparts could earn when they spoke to Italian internationals after a game. At a time when English football had a strict £9 a week maximum wage, Italian star Giuseppe Meazza was earning £35 a week, roughly 4 times as much as his English counterparts. Over a period of 44 years, from 1952 to 1996, Italian teams essentially held a monopoly over the progression of the world record transfer fee, only ever briefly interrupted by La Liga side Barcelona. That is in grave contrast to the current landscape in which English and Spanish sides tend to dominate the spending leagues, with no Italian having set a world record fee since Lazio signed Hernan Crespo some 20 years ago. There are a couple of reasons why Italian clubs began to fall behind in terms of their financial capabilities, part of which was their own doing and part of which they had little control over. We'll start with the latter, which was the creation of the Premier League in 1992 and the enormous injection of cash which has flooded into English football ever since. From the mid-1990s onwards, as the financial success of the Premier League snowballed, suddenly English clubs could compete for the world's top talent. This is reflected in the number of players who left Italian clubs to join Premier League teams during this period, such as Adrian Mutu, Hernan Crespo, and Juan Sebastian Baron, all of whom arrived for significant fees. Similarly, during the late 1990s and early 2000s, Barcelona and Real Madrid increasingly began to flex their financial muscles, most notably in the case of Real Madrid with their Galacticos policy, following Florentino Perez being elected club president in 2000. As with the leading Premier League teams, Real Madrid and Barcelona began to poach some of Italian football's top talent, such as Zinedine Zidane, Ronaldo, and Lilian Thuram. Of course, there is very little that Italian clubs could have done to prevent the creation of the Premier League, or Spain's biggest clubs becoming a little more extravagant in the transfer market. But were it not for their own short-sightedness, they too could have increased their financial capabilities. Whilst the Premier League's breakaway in 1992 meant England's top teams could strike their own collective TV deals, Serie A didn't break away from Serie B and start striking collective deals themselves until 2010, by which stage they were already miles behind the Premier League in terms of revenue. To put the financial success of the Premier League into some perspective, having been formed in 1992, when English football was miles behind the Italian game, it was already the most lucrative league in Europe by 2002, just 10 years on. Fast forward to 2020, and the most recent Premier League TV deal was worth over £1.6 billion, roughly double the latest Serie A deal, worth £862 million, which ranks as only the fifth highest on the continent. There's more to this than just the way in which the deals are structured and how the Premier League pioneered on this front too. Whilst Italian football ruled the roost, Italian teams largely fought for national supremacy, and either took international following for granted or didn't consider it a priority. So whilst Serie A teams poured funds into ensuring local supporters followed their team, or whilst Juventus tried to expand their reach throughout Italy, Premier League teams had set their sights much further, exploring the much larger markets of Africa, Asia, and North America. The result of that more global outlook has paid dividends, with the Premier League being by far the most watched league outside of Europe, increasing Premier League clubs' coffers through not just overseas TV deals, but also commercial revenue through things like endorsement deals and merchandising. Another problem for Italian teams, which becomes increasingly evident with every passing season, is the poor state of Italian football stadiums. Whilst only a handful of football stadiums in the upper reaches of the English game aren't owned by the clubs who play there, such arrangements are commonplace in Italian football. Most stadiums are owned by their local councils rather than the clubs, and this can be problematic. Whilst a team like Manchester United or Liverpool can make constant upgrades and renovations to Old Trafford and Anfield when they feel they are required or that it is financially prudent to do so, teams like Roma and Lazio, who share the council-owned Stadio Olimpico, have no such control. The combination of the Taylor Report, which was commissioned following the Hillsborough disaster, and the increased wealth of English clubs with the creation of the Premier League led to an enormous improvement in the quality of football stadia in England, many of which could be accused of being a little soulless, but certainly not unsafe or uncomfortable. Many Italian football stadiums were either built or renovated to host the 1990 World Cup, and have been left virtually untouched ever since. As the Italian economy has endured tough times, local councils are reluctant to divert funds towards renovating football stadiums, and the result is often damp, crumbling grounds, which can be unpleasant environments in which to watch football at best, and genuinely dangerous at worst. When Juventus waved goodbye to the Stadio delle Alpi and moved into the Allianz Stadium in 2009, many were surprised to see Italy's most popular team build a ground which only held 41,000 people. Juve didn't want the biggest stadium in Italy though, they just wanted something that was modern, comfortable, and intimate. The Stadio delle Alpi was a miserable place to watch a football match, and many Italian grounds are essentially crumbling concrete shells with running tracks which leave the few fans who still attend games some distance away from the pitch. All things considered, is it any wonder that Serie A, once the most watched league in Europe, had an average attendance of just 17,949 this season, putting it behind the MLS and only marginally ahead of the Championship in the worldwide stakes? Whilst the seeds of Serie A's decline had already been sown in the mid-1990s, Italian clubs continued to be some of the best in Europe over the next decade. The 2003 Champions League final was an all-Italian affair between AC Milan and Juventus, and between 2003 and 2007, a superb AC Milan side reached three out of a possible five Champions League finals, winning two of them and losing one in extraordinary fashion. Throughout this period of the mid-2000s, AC Milan were rightly considered to be the most gifted team in Europe. You need only look at their starting 11 from the 2005 Champions League final, featuring legends of the game from 1 to 11, and the likes of Alessandro Costa Curta and Rui Costa on the bench, to know that Italian football still had plenty of fight left in it. The really damning and near fatal blow for the Italian game came over the next few years, between 2006 and 2008. In 2006, Italian football was rocked by the Calciopoli scandal, which I won't go into, since that is a rabbit hole which would require an entire video in of itself, but needless to say, the consequences of that scandal would be significant, and indeed, are still being felt today. Italy's biggest club Juventus was stripped of two Scudettos and sent down into Serie B, which resulted in major players like Fabio Cannavaro, Lilian Thuram, and Zlatan Ibrahimovic leaving the club. More importantly, it called the integrity of the division into question, something which caused untold damage to the reputation of the league as a whole. Many fans can accept uncomfy seats and a rubbish view of the pitch, but doubts over the legitimacy of matches and the competition can be rather more difficult to stomach. Beyond the fans, overseas audiences, and foreign players and managers came to view Serie A as something of a shambles. The league's varnish had been wearing away for a decade, but an unprecedented scandal like Calciopoli took out a whole chunk. Just in case the Calciopoli scandal wasn't enough, in 2008, the global financial crisis arrived. As its name suggests, the financial crisis of 2008 impacted virtually every nation on Earth, but Italy was one of the heaviest hit nations within the European Union. Already saddled by public debt, the Great Recession crippled the Italian economy, leading to mass unemployment and the second highest debt to GDP ratio in the entire EU, second only to Greece. Many owners of Italian football clubs found their wealth greatly diminished by the financial crisis, with inevitable knock-on effects for their recruitment and ambition off the pitch. Whilst Manchester City were being taken over by the wealthiest owner in world football in 2008, and Real Madrid twice broke the world record transfer fee in a single transfer window in 2009, many Italian clubs were forced to recalibrate and set their sights far lower. As I said at the start of this video, it is only through a concoction of internal and external factors that something as significant as a league going from being the best in the world to only the fourth strongest in Europe can occur. Once you take into account the improvements that occurred in other leagues, the way in which Italian clubs failed to properly promote themselves across much of the globe and monetize their TV rights, the crumbling stadiums, dwindling crowds, scandals, decrease in real star power, and Italy having been particularly hard hit by the Great Recession, it's not hard to see why the league has gradually fallen behind others from across the continent. It's also worth noting, when discussing the drop-off of Italian teams in Europe, the sheer impact that Cristiano Ronaldo and Lionel Messi have had on this era of football. Whilst both players have shown that they cannot win the Champions League single-handedly this season, with good players around them, they have shaped the European game over much of the last 10 to 15 years, winning 9 Champions League titles between them during a period in which Italian teams have only won the competition twice. So what next for Serie A? Is the league dead and buried, or are there some causes for optimism? Well, in truth, the answer is a bit of both. Most of the problems within the Italian game have been left unaddressed for the last 20 years, but there are just one or two signs that things are starting to be done. As mentioned, Serie A teams rearranged their broadcasting rights in 2010, and the arrival of Cristiano Ronaldo did lead to an uptick in interest of viewership of Italian football's top flight last season. What's more, Juventus aren't the only team to realise the importance of owning your own stadium and playing football in a hospitable venue. Atalanta bought their stadium, the Stadio Atleti Azzurri d'Italia, from Bergamo City Council in 2017 for just €8.6 million, immediately spending €2.6 million on vital renovations before unveiling a €40 million redevelopment plan which is set to be completed in 2021. AC and Inter Milan will move out of the San Siro and into the new Milan Stadium at some stage, meanwhile Roma have already made plans to build a new 52,000-seater stadium and move out of the Stadio Olimpico. Elsewhere, the likes of Fiorentina, Hellas Verona, Crotone, Empoli, Brescia and Cagliari have all put forward proposals for new stadiums of their own, which won't come cheap, but might just propel Italian football into the 21st century and lead to an upsurge in matchday attendance. Another problem for Italian football has been the dominance of Juventus over the last decade, and the struggles of traditional titans like the two Milan clubs. In those glory days between 1983 and 1998, there were 7 different Scudetto winners, and the league went almost a decade without a single team retaining the Serie A title. That couldn't be much further contrasted with the last 9 years of sheer Juventus dominance, but with the rise of Inter Milan under Antonio Conte and the fairytale story of Giampiero Gasperini's project at Atalanta, among others, perhaps there could be hope just yet in terms of some unpredictability and excitement returning to the top end of Italian football. There are still massive problems. Make no mistake, and a lot of good decisions will have to be made if Serie A is going to rival the Premier League and La Liga over the coming decade. But you all know that I'm an absolute barrel of joy, so I thought why not finish on a positive note. That's it from me then, thank you all for watching. Please do hit the like button if you enjoyed this video, or felt that you learned anything about the decline of Italian football. Let me know your thoughts down below in the comments, and make sure you are subscribed to HITC Sevens. There are a number of other factors that I could have mentioned, such as the lack of goals in Italian football during much of the league's glory days, which was adored by many Italians, but perhaps didn't help its global appeal, as the Premier League went on a tear during the 1990s and early 2000s, with its fast-paced end-to-end style becoming viewed as the more entertaining product of football. But it's always the case that I can't mention everything, and if I did, the video would be an hour long, and I suspect not many people would fancy sitting through it all. Thanks again for watching, and if you'd like to follow me on Instagram or Twitter, where I sometimes post polls, fascinating footballing insights, or just photos of my beautiful face, you can do so with the username @HITC7s on both platforms.